Okay, so we will now start group theory. So this is the second chapter, and the very first section is the definition of a group. To motivate this definition, we go back to the last result from section 1.2. If you recall, in section 1.2, we dealt with mappings or functions. So let us see what that last result was. In section 1.2, we define A of S for any non-empty set S to be the set of all one-to-one mappings of S onto itself. So A of S is the set of all one-to-one mappings of S onto itself, or all bijective mappings on S, or all one-to-one correspondences on S. One more thing that we came across is this. In A of S, we defined a binary operation which we denote by this symbol, a small circle called composition of mappings that satisfies the following properties. Okay, so we, if you recall, in that last theorem, we actually consolidated all the lemmas that we proved about composition of mappings in that section, and we had them in one place. So we are going to recall them, but before that, you also recall what binary operation means. If you remember the examples that we saw in section 1.2 after the definition of mappings, there in one example we defined a binary operation to be a function that is like this. When we have such a function where S is a set, then we say that F is a binary operation on the set S. And there we also saw that if this is an element in S cross S, then instead of denoting the image of this element under F by the usual functional notation, we denote it by this, something like this, where we put a symbol in between the two things, the two elements in S. And we, when we denote the image like this, we say that this is an operation that operates on these two objects in S and gives us again another third object in S. So in that sense, this is a binary operation, because when we take composition of two functions, say we have sigma and tau, two functions for which the composition sigma, composition tau makes sense. Then this is again a function. We have already seen these things. So now let us recall the four properties that we have seen in that section. The first one is this: for any sigma and tau in A of S, we have sigma composition tau also in A of S. This we already know. That is, in other words, if we say everything in detail, it means that if sigma and tau are both bijective mappings on S, then their composition is also a bijective mapping on S. And we express this by saying that A of S is closed under the operation composition. Actually binary operation, but since we will be primarily dealing with only binary operations, so we do not write the word binary. For us right now, operation will mean binary operation. If it is something else, it will be explicitly expressed there. Then one more thing that we came across is this: for any three elements in A of S, we have this associative law, sigma composition tau composition mu. So this is also known as the associative law, or we sometimes also say that composition of mappings is associative. Then number three, there is a special element iota in A of S. If you recall our videos about mappings, iota, we recall, is the identity mapping on S, which does not change any input. You take some element of S and use it as input in iota. Iota gives you X back. It does not change anything. So it's the identity mapping such that. And we also came across this property of identity mappings, that with respect to composition, it does not change anything. That is, or in other words, it does not have any effect on composition for all sigma in A of S. And one more thing that we saw is this: for every element sigma in A of S, there exists another element sigma inverse in A of S, which we know is the inverse mapping of sigma. We have actually shown that for every such sigma, such an inverse mapping exists such that this happens. Sigma composition sigma inverse is equal to iota, and this is equal to sigma inverse composition sigma. Okay, so these four properties we have already seen in this section. We have proved them and we have written them as a theorem at the end of the section. Okay, now the fact is that we now let us now look at this composite object which has two components. One of them is, the first one is a set. In this case, it is the set of all bijective mappings on S, and the second one is a binary operation on that set, which takes two elements from the set and operates on them and gives us a third element of the set, such that these properties are true. Now, this is not the only system with these properties. There are many systems like this in mathematics and outside of mathematics which satisfy similar properties. So, mathematicians have decided to call them collectively groups, and this example motivates the definition of a group. So, let us just go through the definition and then we will discuss why we need to make an abstract definition. In short, okay, so this is the definition. Let G be a non-empty set. Let dot be a binary operation on G such that the following conditions hold. Number one, for any two elements G and H in G, we have G dot H also in G. Okay, so this is sometimes known as closure property. So its source is this one, the first one. Oh, we have a wrapped part of it. Okay, anyway, so just like we say that here A of S is closed under the binary operation, so here we have a general binary operation and we are requiring that this be true, that G be closed under this operation. So it's known as the closure property. There also I mentioned that it's called closure property. Then the second one, you can now understand what the other properties or the other conditions are supposed to be. for every G, H and K belonging to G, we have G dot H dot K equal to G dot H dot K. This is the associative law. Then I think the full stop will be here inside or not at all. It's not that important where I put the period or full stop. Then the third one is just like iota, here also there will be an element that behaves like iota. There is an element E in G such that A dot E equals A, which is also equal to E dot A. Okay, we don't express this, we say G has an identity element in this case and E is called an identity element. Okay, so this is the third condition, and the fourth one, for every G, we didn't mention one thing, sir. You can include it here, for every A belonging to G. These equations must be true for all A in G, for every element A in G. Or if we want, for the sake of uniformity and presentation, instead of calling this A, let us just call it G. For every G belonging to G, then for every element G in G, there exists an element What symbol should I use? Okay, for now let me just arbitrarily use G prime belonging to G such that G dot G prime is equal to that identity element, which is equal to G prime dot G. In this case, we call G prime an inverse of G. So, the first one is known as closure property. It says that G is closed under this binary operation. The second one is associativity or associative law. The third one says that there exists an identity element in G which has no effect on that binary operation, in this sense, that these equations are true for all elements G in capital G. And the fourth one says that every element, for every element, there exists another element, G prime, which is not necessarily different from that element. It's not necessary that G prime has to be something distinct from G. That may be the same thing, it may be different, that is not the point. The point is that there should be one element G prime for every element G, such that these equations are true. That when we operate on G and G prime in any order, we get that identity element. If this happens, then we say that G prime is an inverse of the element G. Okay. So what is the definition saying? So we are assuming that dot is a binary operation on G such that these conditions are true. Suppose this is true, then we call this a group. This composite object consisting of the set and the binary operation on it is called a group. If the binary operation dot is understood, we also sometimes call G itself a group. This is abuse of notation. The actual notation is this, which clearly shows that a group has two parts, a set and a binary operation on that set. That satisfies these four things. But every time writing such a thing, it becomes cumbersome after some point. So if you are working with a single group, then you can suppress the binary operation from the notation by not writing it, and write simply write G and call G itself a group. But you should keep in mind that in the background there is a binary operation. If you just call, say, this set is a group, that does not mean anything. It is meaningless. You have to, if the binary operation is already not understood, then you have to mention what is the binary operation. Without any operation, the set is just simply a set, nothing else. But a group is a composite object consisting of a set and a binary operation. Okay. Now note that this binary operation, although we are using this symbol is not fixed. You can use any symbol, just like you can use any symbol for a binary operation. After all, it's a mapping from G cross G into G. So for any two elements G and H in G, you can denote their the element that you get when you apply this operation on them, that element you can denote by G dot H, or you can denote it by G star H, or say G triangle H. In anything you can use, any symbol is okay. You can even use, if F is denoting that mapping, you can in fact even use G F H. But it's advisable to use something other than English letter, because otherwise you may confuse yourself into thinking that F is also an element of G. Okay. So these are some things about the notation or simplification of the notation. So if you come back to this video after watching for the first time and you go through this, will you remember this thing, or should I write? Let us not write these things. I have already said what we mean by this, So we leave it like this here. Okay, now we come to the question of why we need this abstract definition. And then we will look at the each of these conditions somewhat more closely. So we now come to the why part of the definition. There are mainly two reasons for making an abstract definition. See, in mathematics, something is defined based on different motivations. That motivation sometimes can be aesthetic, or sometimes it can be the fact that something is giving rich results, that there are many interesting results that come as a consequence of some abstract definition, then that can be defined. Now here, the main reason is this. You see, the motivation for our definition was, it seems like one example. This group. Okay. So now, having looked at the definition, it's not a surprise that this is a group. For any non-empty set, this is a group. Okay. Now there are many other groups. I have already said that, I think. So the thing is that if we now have an abstract definition, then we can study that abstract definition itself without having to study each and every group separately, so that when we derive some general results about this abstract group, that result can be applied to each group to know more about that group. That is one reason. It reduces our labor, or reduces unnecessary repetition. We may think that we are doing something different when, say, we are working with this group, and then we come across some other concrete group in some particular example like this, and we may think that we are again getting a new result, but actually in the background we are just studying a simple aspect of general group theory. So then we are not necessarily doing anything different than what we did with this example, and we are wasting our time and labor. So to prevent us from doing that thing, we need a general definition. That is one reason. Another reason is that special groups sometimes come not only with group structure, but some extra things in them. Now those extra things work like the glare of a star. You see, when a star means an actual star, okay, if you have a star, say, in space, then some planets are orbiting the star. If you are looking at the star from a great distance, these planets may not be visible in the glare of the star. So that unnecessary glare hinders us from in our quest for these planets. So if we can somehow get rid of the unnecessary information from those concrete examples of groups and extract only what we need, we only need the group structure, in the sense that we only need to study that aspect of this system which depends only on this binary operation and what it does to the elements of this set, then we may see the planets. Okay. And then when we apply these results back to this example, we may turn out that there are some results which was previously not visible in that sea of unnecessary information. So that's why we need abstract definitions, and an abstract study of group can be justified in that way. Okay. Now let us look at some aspects of this definition. You see, shall I write it formally, or let me just Let us just discuss about it. Actually, in this definition, you need not even mention condition one, the closure property. Let me tell you why. You can start with condition two. Of course, then it will be condition one. You can just say that G is a non-empty set and dot is a binary operation on G that is associative with respect to dot. There is an identity element, and with respect to dot, every element has an inverse. Then we call this system a group. I am not saying anything about closure property. Why? The reason is that when we have a binary operation, then by definition it's a mapping from G cross G into G. So that means if I have two elements G and H in G, then since this is a binary operation, it's a mapping into G. So this image has to belong to G. So the moment you say that dot is a binary operation, closure property is already there. You don't need to mention it separately. It does not happen that we have a binary operation and then we don't have closure property. But then it's not a binary operation at all in the first place. So that's why there is no real need to mention condition one, but still it is mentioned simply because it is an important aspect of this definition. Why? Because you see, if you want to study this operation, what it does to these elements of this set. Now, if you look at the associative law, G dot H dot K say is equal to G dot H dot K, where G, H and K are three elements in the set G. Now, if I first perform the operation G dot H, I get some element of G, then the second operation, which is outside, it makes sense because now G dot H is an element of G, K is also an element of G. So I can operate on them. But if dot is not a binary operation, if it is taking me outside, say G dot H is something that is not in G, then this outer operation between G dot H and K is meaningless because dot is only defined here. So if my first element G dot H is not in G, then in spite of having K in G, this does not make sense. So in order to always make these products meaningful, no matter how many operands we have in that product, you can have many more, say G, H, K, I, L, M, N, etc. in whatever manner you can put brackets. That is meaningful because every time you are operating, you are never leaving G, and for that we need the first one, which anyhow is there, the closure property. But just to stress the fact that without the closure property you cannot move forward, you need the closure property first. Then you have associative law. So what does the associative law say? It actually says a lot. It puts a stringent condition on this function. G dot H dot K is equal to G dot H dot K. You see, as far as any function goes, there is no reason for this to be true in general. For example, if you have, say, if you take these three natural numbers and say in place of dot I use ordinary subtraction of integers, then are these things equal? 1 minus 2 minus 3 on one hand, and 1 minus 2 minus 3 on the other hand. The first one becomes 1 minus 2 is minus 1, minus 1 minus 3 is minus 4. What about this one? 2 minus 3 is minus 1, minus of minus 1 is plus 1, so this is equal to 2. So these two things are not equal. This is not equal to this. So if I am thinking, just for the sake of this second condition, if I am thinking of this system, then this system, closure property itself is not true. Let me take integers. Difference of two integers is again an integer, but subtraction of integers is not an associative operation. So there the second property breaks. Why do we need the second property? Let us try to understand that. You see, the second property is needed because of this. Although I am saying it is needed, actually the fact that these conditions have been decided upon is because they arise in many different examples. But still, let us try to see how far a calculation in group goes just from the four axioms. And what are the benefits of these axioms? Say L, G dot H dot K dot L, G dot H dot K dot L, G H K L.